hey, I thought I'd do something different this time. I tried to do a Phil Donahue. A Phil Donahue run-up. Realized I probably shouldn't do that because I'm already out of breath.
Nobody knows who Phil Donahue is.
Good evening, everyone, and welcome to the 10th Annual Incubator EDU Pitch Night at Barrington High School. My name is Hagop Salakian, and I'm finishing my 10th full year as an entrepreneurship teacher and freshman baseball coach here. Thank you. Today, we all once again showcase the students of Barrington High School who have participated in the entrepreneurial experience that culminates with them presenting today. Today is also a special day because I get to introduce someone who has seen this program grow since its inception from a few different roles. Today I'm introducing him as our new superintendent and letting him share his thoughts. Please give a warm welcome to Dr. Craig Winkleman. Yeah.
Thank you, Hoggs. I did not run up the steps because I would be out of breath as well. But thank you for the introduction and the warm welcome. As Hoggs mentioned, I can't believe I'm standing here today on the 10th anniversary of the program. 10 years ago, I was a middle school principal working with Dr. Leonard, and we would have monthly meetings over breakfast to talk about how things were going in the schools. And that year, when this program was being created, I think we talked more about incubator and this concept than we did about other school functions, because Dr. Leonard was so excited and proud of introducing this program to our students here at Barrington High School without any knowledge of where the program would go over 10 years and what it has become today, not only here in Barrington, but across the nation and the country, I'm proud to say. So with that in mind, you know, in my role as superintendent, I get to interact with a number of people, but I'm also a longtime educator, as Hoggs mentioned, and parent in the community. And people share their experiences with me all the time about you know, things that they appreciate about Barrington School District, positive experiences their children have had. And one of the things that consistently comes up is this program. So I'm incredibly proud of the work of this program, the experiences that our students get to have. And what I think stands out with the incubator program is this course goes beyond the normal constructs of education, of an exchange of information or knowledge between a teacher and a student. Our kids get to develop real skills that will translate into life, like problem solving, collaboration and teamwork, getting to work with your team. And then what's going to be on showcase tonight is that speaking, communication skills, all of those things translate beyond the classroom into the real world setting. And I think that's what sets this program apart and is a highlight for Barrington School District. So thank you for allowing me to share some thoughts tonight. I look forward to the pitches. And then just a few thank yous. Certainly thank you to Hoggs for 10 years of the program and working with our students, the support of the high school administrative team, our partners and friends with Uncharted Learning, and those that founded the program, and certainly our educational foundation. So thank you all for making 10 years possible.
Thanks, Craig. 10 years ago, two community members had a dream. The dream turned into a local program, and now, through the Uncharted Learning not-for-profit, it's a worldwide program. I'd like to take this time to recognize these two individuals. The first one, who we'll hear from later, Michael Miles. And our second co-founder, who we'll hear from now to share his thoughts, Mr. Carl Frecht.
Folks, my name is Carl Frecht, and I am a proud 1983 graduate of Barrington High School. Woo-hoo! So how do we get here from 10 years ago? Well, 10 years ago, Barrington was going through some significant change downtown, and I had spent some time with the economic development team in Barrington, and their plan to develop Barrington just didn't seem right. And I'm at a graduation party with Michael Miles, and I'm talking to him about this plan that the village had. And Michael said, wouldn't it be cool if the kids could tell us how to build businesses in Barrington? And wouldn't it be cool if we could get coaches and mentors from the area to participate in that class and help these kids? Wouldn't it be cool if they could do, it could be a real experience and they could come out of this class with more business knowledge than they had before, and it could help them make decisions when they're about to choose which college they want for their career? That's how this whole program started. And around that, we had the ability to supplement it with some fantastic community that embraced it immediately. Dr. Winkleman was in the room for most of these conversations. Dr. Leonard was very excited about it. And a lot of the people on the incubator team now were there day one that helped us get this rolling. We had zero intentions of building this program in Barrington and distributing it past our town. What we were trying to do is help our school bring out better outcomes for our students when they make their college decision. And that's where Incubator EDU got its start. We said, let's create an incubator, just like they have in downtown Chicago, like they have in the Valley, like they have in Research Park in North Carolina, and we will teach kids how to start their own business. No textbooks, no tests. We're gonna give them the knowledge from a business model canvas, and we're going to have them start their own business. That comes with some complications, and we figured them out, thanks to the help of the Educational Foundation. It's clearly not business as usual. When you walk into that classroom, it doesn't look like a high school classroom. What it looks like is a business facility. And kids put their backpacks in their cubbies, and they leave school, and they go to work. And you'll see some of the outcomes here. It's phenomenal what you'll see tonight. Beyond that first year, Dr. Leonard wanted to tell his friends the story about what we were doing here. So I look at Michael, he looks at me, he goes, yeah, we'll have this conversation. He fills the room with 100 people at the GRC, and half of them fly in from out of state. And we're like, why would you give your IP away to education professionals? This is what you do that's different in your business. Well, in education, which we didn't know, you share all that information constantly. And then at that meeting, one of the folks from Naples suggested, hey, we'd like to do this in our school. Could we do it in our school? And at that moment, Incubator EDU was born. From there, we said, let's expand this and not just have a runway for high school kids, but let's have a runway for middle school kids and then for elementary school kids so they can learn about the concepts of business and start to apply them. And we've been pretty successful in doing that. In our elementary school, Fresh Ink is widely distributed throughout the country. Mix Ink is also widely distributed throughout the country. And as already indicated, Incubator EDU is currently being executed in 5 countries. That's around Uncharted Learning, we had some other decisions to make on profit or nonprofit, and we chose the nonprofit route. You're still allowed to make money when you're a nonprofit, but our objective wasn't really to make money. It was to enhance student outcomes. And you can judge for yourself today if we've done anything to affect that. And beyond that, at this point, we have educated over 125,000 students in 5 countries on the concepts of entrepreneurism. They're gaining this information when they're 16 and 17 years old. And we're just learning now how that will affect them when they enter their professional careers. And with that, we were blessed to be, we're blessed to be associated with Hogs. He was our classroom teacher the first year. And uniquely, Michael and I got to select him, and he has been the Pied Piper that we dreamed about when this was just on paper. Hogs?
Yeah.
Before we get started, we have a surprise for Hoggs. As Carl said, Hoggs is the inaugural teacher of the Incubator EDU community. Let's just say many other master teachers, teachers who've trained with us and have contributed to strengthening and improving Incubator, call him the Godfather. So you team members, do that, take that information and run with it. But our good friends at Wintrust Barrington Bank have got a special gift because they understand Hoggs' passion for baseball. But Hoggs doesn't limit that passion to just the sport of baseball. That core of player in him, when things get tough, things get interesting, things need to get more creative, Hoggs is the one who says, give me the ball, coach. So, Nick?
Mm-hmm. There's the ball.
Thank you so much.
So, Hoggs has got the game ball, as usual, and with a special follow-up with the Cubs later, courtesy of Wintrust. And then, as part of training, Hoggs has been part of this journey in training other teachers. And he was the first one to earn the status of Master Incubator Teacher, which means that you're doing more than just teaching the class. You're contributing to the development of other teachers, contributing to the program becoming stronger. So Atlanta may have Masters Golf, but we've got Hoggs the Master. Christy, will you do the honor?
Nice.
That's, are you serious? Oh my God.
Good. I forgot here. Sorry.
Oh my God. Well, this was a major surprise. I just told them, you know, my wife picked out this shirt today, and she goes, yeah, she had something to do. I said, the jacket matches my shirt. She goes, well, your wife had a role in picking out your shirt because they spoke to her, so I didn't know. Okay, well, thank you to everybody. I was not expecting this, but I really appreciate that from the bottom of my heart. I don't even know if I should read the rest of what I have to say going forward, but... wow. Okay. Let me get a sip. Hold on. I always look forward to the end of May and pitch night specifically, not because the end of school is coming, not because the baseball season is ending. This year, not because I'm finishing up my MBA, although those are all good reasons. But for me, pitch night signifies success. Success for my class, success for our school, success for our district, our community, and most importantly, for our students. For the last 10 years, I've truly enjoyed being part of this unbelievable program, and I can still remember the meeting I had with Michael and Carl, the interview that we went through. It was just like it was yesterday. I truly enjoyed being a part of this unbelievable program. Over the last, you know, few years, people have been asking me, do you still love your job? And you know, I thought about that for a while. And it finally came to me. And what I enjoy is not the job. The job to me is the check that I get every 2 weeks. That's the job, and I can get that anywhere. You know, the job doesn't define what I do and what a lot of other teachers do. The question that I should be asked is, do I enjoy my profession? And my profession has allowed me the opportunity to collaborate with unbelievable staff and unbelievable administration on providing me and my students with the resources that we need, helping me grow both personally and professionally. And if anybody saw me 10 years ago, you know, coming in fresh as a new teacher, I remember I had to write letters of recommendation. I had no idea how to, you know, I had the English teachers grading my letters, you know, for 3 or 4 years until I finally got good at it. And obviously assisting on putting on events like this. So people like Amy Jessup and her auditorium tech team, Jeff Doles and his award-winning BHS team, thank you so much for all of your support. My profession has also allowed me to be a part of an unbelievable organization in Uncharted Learning to help keep entrepreneurship at the forefront of problem-based learning within education. I get to make presentations every year on things that I truly enjoy. I get to meet people in the entrepreneurship ecosystem. I get to spend valuable time with other incubator teachers from around the world. My profession connected me with incredible individuals from the community. And through the Educational Foundation, they gave their time, their talent, their treasure to ensure that my class has everything it needs to be successful. The program truly is a public-private partnership and a one-of-a-kind community-based program with over 160 volunteers who have served as content experts and mentors and board members that not only assist the student, but assist me as well. I mentioned before, I started my MBA program in September of 21, and those of you that know me, I was scared as hell to go back to school at age 49. Didn't know if I was ready, didn't know if I was prepared, and I have now started my 13th class. And in the 12 classes that I took, 11 of them, I already knew everything that I needed that they were giving me because of the people, working with the people on the board, working with my mentors, and the people that are coming into the classroom. It was amazing. The teachers, the professors used me as an assistant professor in some of the classes. I didn't have to do some of the assignments. I'm not saying that to be for the board to know, but I was just that far advanced. And it's because of this class that I was. So for those of you thinking what kind of education your kids are getting or the outcome, you're getting pre-MBA work at the high school level. So, you know, I can't tell you how appreciative I am of that. And there's three individuals that I really want to thank who bring the community together. And that's Lisa Gent, Laura Kersinick, and Gina Kortner. Big round of applause for my community champions. Now, finally, this profession, you know, allowed me the most important connections, and those are what I've made with my students over the last 10 years. 841 incubator students, to be exact. You don't realize the impact that you've made until they leave high school. When you travel to Austin and you give a presentation and you get a LinkedIn message from a student you taught 7 years ago that wants to reconnect and explain to you how much incubator changed his life. When students contact you because they want to be part of the presentations as guest judges. When I get to read about all their achievements on LinkedIn and how they credit the program for their development. When former students hop on Zoom to help my accelerator kids because they saw a post on LinkedIn asking for help in certain topics. These are a few examples of why I love my profession. But just recently, I received word that a former student offered to become a mentor in the program. Now you know the program has come full circle. When people that started in the program are now coming back and giving to that program. And that's one of the visions that I had when I began. So I always dreamed about my former students coming back and volunteering. And it's because of this, you know, I sound like the State of the Union now. It's because of this that I can tell you that the state of the program today is strong. It's now I want to take time. You know, we've said a lot of thank yous. We have 11 people on the stage tonight that are a big part of the program. The Educational Foundation Board of Directors for the Incubator Program. These people have seen over the last 10 years 173 presentations. They funded 28 teams at the cost of almost $300,000, and there are still 8 teams in operation. So please, if we can have the board introduce themselves to the audience, and a big round of applause for them, please.
Hi, I'm Jesse Erickson. I'm so happy to be here tonight. I'm the chairperson of the Educational Foundation. I also have 2 kids in the district. And I just want to say how awestruck I am by every single student who it takes the incubator class. It takes smarts and guts. And even if you didn't make it to pitch night, or if you did, I'm in awe of you.
Yeah. My name is Eric Lunt. I am a BHS class of 88, coming back. Was on this stage many times under the direction of Mr. Hands in the band. I don't know if anyone remembers Mr. Hands, but I'm also a trustee on the Education Foundation and a serial entrepreneur, and I just love this night. I can't wait to see all the pitches. Thanks.
My name is Nick Howard, and I've been honored to be working with the Ed Foundation and the incubator since the beginnings, and I'm a banker working in the commercial real estate space in Barrington.
I'm Chris Flans. I'm an entrepreneur turned venture capitalist. Recently moved to the Barrington area. I have 2 young kids. Only one is in elementary school at Rose. Partake in the foundation as a trustee and a donor, and I just, this scratches all the itches of the old corporate life. I just can't believe how advanced all these kids are. Blows my mind.
Good evening. My name is Burt Groom. I manage the business banking group at Barrington Bank and Trust, one of the Wintrust community banks here in town. I get the privilege of working with businesses day in, day out. So to come here and see the ideas, hear the ideas of these young kids is amazing and fun. So thank you, kids, for all you're doing. I've had 2 kids go through the Barrington schools, and I've been here for 20 years, and thank you for allowing me to be here tonight.
Hello, I'm Patrick Mitten, and I'm delighted to be with all of you this evening. I'm honored to share that this is my 9th year serving the incubator program as a mentor, advisor, and board member. I'm an entrepreneur, operating executive, and business owner. I worked most of my career in the food and beverage industry. My family and I moved to Barrington over 35 years ago when I joined Quaker Oats across the street. Today, my wife and I own and lead a manufacturing company that makes precision engineered packaging equipment. All of our equipment is designed and built right here in Chicagoland. As an entrepreneur, I appreciate the hard work all the students demonstrated this year, and I'm looking forward to another exciting evening of pitches.
Hello, everyone. Thank you for coming this evening. My name is Margarita Gilleski, and I had the distinctive opportunity of chairing the Educational Foundation back in 2012. When Michael and Carl had a what-if idea, an idea that they thought this is really something that should be in our schools, and thankfully Dr. Leonard, Steve McWilliams, Ty Gorman all said yes, absolutely, and Leanne Taylor as well as Kelly Hansen. So now I've got the privilege of helping other schools in other areas of the country launch their own incubator EDU and really enrich in this entire community. We look forward to a great night. Good luck to all.
So, hi, I'm Christy Scott. I'm the executive director at Uncharted Learning, and I have the privilege of leading a wonderful team of 13 people now who serve over 170 school districts in the United States and beyond. I was also one of the original volunteers and have that lucky moment of being called in to contribute to the start of this while I had 3 kids under the age of maybe 8, and now 2 have at least gone through the program. Good luck tonight, it's gonna be awesome.
I'm Mike McElroy, I'm a local attorney. Part of what I do is organize and advise businesses. I'm also a trustee on the Educational Foundation by wife, and I've got a middle schooler and an elementary student who are in the audience. This is one of their favorite nights. We talk about what happens here, and we're all looking forward to a great evening.
Thank you. Hi, everyone. I'm Michael Miles. I am a Barrington resident. I have five children that went through the high school here, and I'm an entrepreneur, and you know, I'm the guy that Carl and I, you know, sat down with and said, hey, what if? And it was, you know, some things in life are funny. That was not a really intentional, like, premeditated what if. It was just, you know, two people having a conversation, and really proud of the students and proud of the parents here and the mentors and the coaches and everybody. So thank you all for contributing to an incredible program. Professionally, I run a private equity firm. I'm an entrepreneur and kind of second career private equity investor. I started a company when I was very young and grew it. And now I invest in companies and buy them and you know, hopefully sell them. Buy low, sell high. That's kind of how it works. So looking forward to hearing your presentations tonight, and I'll turn it over to Carl.
You've met me, Carl Frecht. I graduated here in 1983. Professionally, I am an intrapreneur. I start small companies inside of large companies that become the new way they do business. Call it modernization, call it digital transformation. And ladies and gentlemen, go Phillies and go Broncos!
Thank you, board. So let's go over the agenda really quick today, and then we're going to get started. You're going to hear five groups present today. They're in order in the program. They'll have 8 minutes to present, and then the board will have 5 minutes to ask questions. I will let you know when there's a minute left so you can time it accordingly. And then after the five presentations, the board will then go to the back and have their deliberations. And at that time, I have a couple special guests that I'll be announcing that can share some of their thoughts on the program and what they've done with it since they left the high school. So, now that we got all the introductions done, now that we have the agenda, the structure, everything, now it's ready to get started. So, the first group that'll be taking the stage is SportsGo, mentored by Peter Schenk. It's a sports service, it's a website that connects parents to high school athletes in their area to get kids playing sports and to better their sports and social skills. Please welcome Sam Ansani, Dhruv Chavda, Owen Mall, Rhea Raju, and Alex Stoika.
It's going, hold on.
Let's get it. Hop off a 16 passenger. This is G5. No, this not a Challenger. Big one.
Hi, I'm Dhruv Chavda. This is Sam. That's Rhea. That's Owen. And that's Alex. And we are SportsGo. Once upon a time, there was a little 6-year-old boy named Alex Adams. He signed up for soccer, thinking it would be fun. But when the season started, he realized that it was actually super competitive, and he was one of the worst ones in the whole league. However, one day, he scored a goal. But it's for the other team. His mom, Isabella Adams, was also getting tired of driving him around to watch him score own goals, but she still wanted to find a way to make soccer fun for him. The problem that we were trying to solve is that kids either aren't playing sports or they aren't enjoying the current sport, leading them to quit. And we don't want that happening. But unfortunately, it's already happening. Did you know that about 70% of kids in the U.S. quit playing sports by the age of 13 because it's just not fun anymore, and they've lost interest because they feel that they don't have potential? However, playing sports comes with many benefits. In a recent study, 88% of kids experienced an improvement in physical health, and 73% experienced an improvement in mental health as well. Now, our sports tutoring service connects parents to high school athletes in their area to help improve the child's sports and social skills. Things that make us stand out is that we're convenient, affordable, and the social benefits aspect of our company. Starting off with the convenience, we understand that parents may not have the time to drive the kids around to different places, so that is why we have an option where our trainers can come to you guys. Second, we're affordable. We are far more affordable compared to our competitors. We offer a price that is lower than almost all sports training facilities in Illinois, but still provide sufficient training. And lastly, the social benefits aspect of our company. Not only are the kids playing sports, but they are also interacting with an older individual, which is beneficial towards developing good social skills. Some benefits that come from social skills are friendship, team building skills, leadership, self-confidence, lower stress, better concentration, and better mood. Having well-developed social skills helps children become active community members, which helps them know more about what's going on in the world around them. I'm sure all parents want their children to have a very bright and healthy future. So why not start working towards that at a young age?
So this is the landing page for our website. Our website is our main source of communication for scheduling sessions with the parents, with our trainers. As you can see, there are sports balls in the bottom left-hand corner. Once you click on any one of these sports balls, it takes you to our Calendly. Our Calendly is where you can schedule a session with one of our trainers. We have our listed days here, along with the time of our session, the length of our session, and the price. Once you pick a time, it takes you to where we will be collecting emails. Once we collect emails, the parents can pick the trainer they want their kid to be working with. So basically, each of our trainers has their own bio. The parents can read about each of the trainers and select who they want their child working with. Once everything is picked, it is shown on the left-hand side.
The total sports training market is $11 billion. Of that $11 billion, we will be targeting around $500,000. We also estimated that around 2,000 kids play sports in the Barrington area, excluding high schoolers. So our target customer would be parents with children ages 5 to 13 who play sports, live in the Barrington area, and have a household income of over $100,000. So for our competitors, we have the Barrington Park District and Canlan Sportsplex. One of the differences between the competitors and us is the price. They offer a $50 to $60 45-minute session, while we are just $40 for 45 minutes. Another difference is convenience. We are far more convenient as the trainers can come to the customers instead of the customers just coming to the trainers. Here are some marketing tactics we will be implementing. First of all, for the trainers, we will use word of mouth, flyers given to BHS coaches, and BHS TV. However, for the customers, we will be using BHS TV, direct phone calls, word of mouth, email lists, and posters and ads throughout Barrington.
So with our marketing, we found that we need to charge $40 per session. Of that $40, $15 will be going towards the trainers. $1.17 goes towards the credit card fees charged by the virtual payment companies, and the rest of that goes to our company at $23.83. With this, we found our year one gross profit, which is around $6,000. Our gross profit is the amount of money we will make after our cost of goods sold. We also found our market share, which is 2.2% of the serviceable addressable market that we plan to target. We found this by taking the total amount of customers we wish to reach, taking our calculated conversion rate, and that gave us the total amount of customers we will reach in year one. In year five, we predict we will have a $305,000 gross profit. We found this by expanding our serviceable addressable market to the northwest suburbs instead of just the Barrington area. We will also have recruited trainers from all around the northwest suburbs at this time.
So what is an MVP? An MVP is a minimal viable product, and this is basically where we test our service in its early stages and make adjustments based on the feedback that we get. So what did we test as SportsGo? We tested our price, our trust, and our consistency. Originally, we were set at $35 for a 45-minute session, but we soon realized that we were not creating enough revenue from this, so we increased our price to $40. Next, we wanted to test our trust. Do parents trust their kids with random high school athletes? And the answer is they did. A lot of times, the parents were around the area while we were training the kids, and also, the bios that are on our website allowed the parents to get to know the children themselves. Finally, we tested our consistency to see how many sessions we could consecutively run. We soon realized that we were weather dependent. When the weather is better, we can run more sessions consecutively. We received feedback from both the parents and the children. For feedback from the parents, we realized that we have to make the times of our trainers this available at a more convenient time, so when parents schedule the sessions, they align with the trainer schedules. And from the kids, they wished that some of the curriculum that we were giving them was harder. We ourselves make the curriculum for the children. And after this feedback, we expanded our curriculum to make certain drills harder while other ones are shorter. And there's more variety based on that. Also, two of our group sessions with more than 2 to 3 kids, they wished that the time was a lot longer. So we also took that into account. Over our MVP stage, we conducted a total of 8 sessions, had 10 customers, and from this, we generated a total of $355 in revenue.
So in total, we are asking for $4,000. This includes $150 for an LLC, $350 for sports training insurance for the whole year for the whole company, $240 for marketing, which includes our online advertisements through sites like Nextdoor and Facebook, and then $240 for our website development, which includes Calendly, where we can have the customers now paid directly through Calendly, which is more efficient, as well as through Wix. We need to create a domain name for our website so then it's not just a random name. And then a liquidity cushion of $2,750 in case we don't meet our year one projected goals, and also it would cover some of our company costs. So in total, this is $4,000, and we are hoping to give 10% ownership of our company. And then we are expected to sell in year 5 to a financial buyer, and then the investor is expected to get 8 times their money in return, a 56% internal rate of return, which is the annual growth rate on their investment, and then we hold a $38,000 post-money valuation.
Get your kids moving and on the go with SportsGo.
Thank you.
Board, you have 5 minutes.
Excellent presentation. Thank you very much for telling us about SportsGo. So just one clarifying question. So your trainers are, at this point, are Barrington High School sports, people that play sports at Barrington High School. Is that correct? Okay, and as you would expand the market, you would potentially reach maybe other schools and recruit there?
Yeah, that is our plan going through the 1 through 5 years.
That's great. So next year, to hit your numbers for next year, how many trainers do you think you'd need to recruit and have kind of available for you?
So we right now it's just us training in the MVP stage, but we plan to get quite a few more trainers from our high school, and that'll mostly cover the amount we need, because we don't expect to grow a ginormous amount in years 1 through 2, but in years 3 and 5, we will be growing much wider, and at that point we will need to get trainers from other high schools and other areas.
Thank you.
Great job going first. Amazing presentation. Good job. It's not just about the sports, it's about the social benefits that are there too. Walk us through an example of what the kids' mind was like after you got done, and did they want to do it again?
Well,
so, a lot of the times, younger kids hanging out with older kids is it kind of makes them feel cool, you know? if a younger kid is hanging out with an older kid, and after that training session, they go back home, they go to school, they're like, I hung out with this high schooler who's super cool, and now he's my friend. You don't have that friend that I have. So that kind of ties in with the social benefits aspect of our company, and it just makes the kids feel cooler at school, and that gives them more confidence, which just helps them better overall in the future.
And adding on to that, when I did train these 3 girls who played volleyball, they were in my neighborhood, and when they first came in, just amongst themselves, they were who are you? I don't want to play volleyball with this random girl. But as we went through it, and they finally started playing with each other and connecting and doing drills, by the end of it, they were best friends, and they all wanted to hang out outside of our session. So that just shows that it's not only between the child and the trainer, it's between the kids themselves.
Awesome. Thank you.
Great job. Great idea. I'll be a recurring customer. I'm rooting for you guys. two kids that need this badly. I mean, I look at you like a babysitter with an athletic agenda, right? It's amazing. So as a parent, I mean, how do you plan to make me and other parents comfortable with the trainers, right? You'll be with alone with my kids. You talk a little bit about a rating system, or have you researched anything, other babysitting like care.com? That'd be a good comp business, similar. But you add quite a bit of flair on top of that.
Yeah, so basically, when we did do sessions, a lot of times they were at like local parks in the area or just somewhere close by to the parents' houses themselves. So for a few of our own sessions, we had the parents, like one of ours was in a backyard, and the parents were, you know, just gardening outside or cooking, so they were like watching their kids. So it's not like the parents just like giving their child away to like a high school student for 45 minutes. They can be around them, watch what's happening, and like, you know, get to know the trainer themselves.
Just know that I'd want to leave them with you as long as possible.
Got it.
1 minute left, 1 minute.
Did you do in your MVP testing research on, you know, how much you're paying your coaches and if you can vary that amount to attract more coaches or do back-to-back sessions to lighten your cost and targeting, you know, different types of arrangements like that?
Yeah. So for we chose $15 for $40 because if you do like hourly, that would be about $20 an hour, and I'd say $20 an hour is pretty good for a 16-year-old. So that's how we got that number. But we will also, if there's like group sessions, we'll increase the cost per kid, so the trainers will get more money if they're doing more than one kid.
And to add on to that, sometimes high school athletes or just high schoolers in general, they want to find some place to work and they want to like make money, but sometimes they don't know where to go or where to start. But with us, if someone's passionate about sports, all they have to do is just spend time with a kid and teach them how to play what they're passionate about. So that's an easy way to make a lot of money, which attracts more high school athletes.
Thank you, board. Thank you, Sports Go. Next up, we have Mercury Marketing and their mentor, Joe Holland. Mercury Marketing is a digital marketing agency that uses innovative AI tools to create effective, tailored marketing strategies for small to medium-sized businesses. Please welcome Nathan Koikera, Ayan Mohammed, Ved Patel, Hope Regis, and Devin Shah.
My name is Devin Shah.
My name is Ved Patel.
And my name is Hope Regis.
And we are Mercury Marketing. Let me tell you a story of our first customer, Comfort Air Inc. Comfort Air Inc. is a heating, ventilation, and cooling company that wanted to expand and be as successful as possible. And they realized the importance of digital marketing when doing this. However, they had no prior experience or knowledge and thus spent thousands and thousands of dollars on ineffective digital marketing companies that promised a big game but provided nothing. This led Comfort Air to join the 45% of businesses nationwide that have no digital marketing. And of these 45% of businesses, 60% of them fail within the first 10 years. Both of these statistics perfectly represent the importance and the crucial need for proper digital marketing strategies in today's day and age. And seeing the struggle of businesses like Comfort Air inspired us to create a digital marketing company that's not only effective, but innovative, and would solve all the HVAC companies' problems. And that's how we came up with the idea for Mercury Marketing.
Mercury Marketing is an all-encompassing digital marketing agency for small to medium-sized HVAC companies that specializes in Google Ads. We developed a three-step marketing strategy for these HVAC companies using landing page design, Facebook, and Google. The first step is we set up a landing page on either Facebook or a conventional website so their customers have a way to interact with their business online. The next step is to use Facebook retargeting. By installing a Facebook pixel into the landing page, we are able to retarget ads on Facebook to people that have already visited their landing page. This has shown to be very successful for some of the most successful HVAC companies. The next step is we take up the most digital territory we can on the search page by creating a Google business profile, local service ads, and Google search ads take up the most digital space, so whenever a customer looks for them, our clients are visible. This will cost our customer, for us to set it up and run it, $2,200. That's $1,200 in ad spend, which they will pay, and we will be taking $1,000 in revenue.
Out of the $1,000, $525 goes towards labor costs, which means that 47.5% will go towards our profit margin.
With this pricing strategy, we hope to get 16 customers by the end of year one. And with these 16 customers, we'll have a net profit of $16,000, and that will increase to $715,000 in net profit by the end of year five with 138 customers under our belt. We believe that while this is an ambitious goal, we can easily reach it with our knowledge and prowess and the support of the investors.
But why choose us over companies like Blue Corona, Effective Media Solutions, and Rhino Strategic, who all serve HVAC companies and have similar solutions to us? Well, we have something they don't, and that's AI.
Raise your hand if you've heard of ChatGPT. As you can see, ChatGPT is the most popular AI tool on the planet, and besides its basic uses as a general chatbot, it can also be used in digital marketing itself. I cannot stress this enough. AI is the future of the digital world, and Mercury Marketing prides itself on being a front runner in realizing the potential of it in digital advertising.
We figured out a way to use AI to create Google Ads search headlines and descriptions, create keyword lists for our search campaigns, help create Facebook ad creatives, and use it for HTML coding for our landing pages. All of these allow us to create our marketing plan faster and cheaper than our competitors. But we know that ChatGPT is available to everyone, which is why we're currently also working on designing our own unique AI model using several programming tools such as PyCharm, PyTorch, and Anaconda.
HVAC companies spent $111,000, $574, they spent $1.7 billion in their total market. And out of that, 111,000 HVAC companies in the U.S., there are. And then 49,000 of them do not use any type of digital marketing, which means that there's a lot of room in this industry for our services to help these businesses.
Per usual, Mercury Marketing shoots for the stars. And through this, we take pride in our achievements and our goals. Through our trial process, we sent 1,500 emails, and we soon realized this was ineffective. Then we transitioned over to cold calls. Through this cold calling method, we called over 50 customers or 50 businesses and were able to gain valuable feedback. And through these 50 calls, we were able to secure 10 consultations with 5 HVAC companies, and 2 of those being our customers today.
We knew that after sending all those emails, getting sent to the spam folder, and all those cold calls going to voicemail, we needed a change. So we consulted Google ad expert Camille Bob, the CEO of Staffing Attraction Systems. He taught us his marketing strategy, which he has used to generate over 10 high-ticket clients. This strategy includes LinkedIn marketing to get leads, as well as a 6-step email system with a series of Google ad tips and free offers to help establish a relationship with the prospective client. Over our trial phase, we got 2 customers, SecureSheet and Comfort Air. From SecureSheet, we learned how to close meetings as we scheduled a consultation with their CEO and closed them. Additionally, we were given a $1,400 Google ad spend budget, and we managed to have a 300% increase in website traffic and generated over 5,000 impressions to their website. From our second customer, Comfort Air, we learned that people were willing to pay real money for our services. From Comfort Air, we made $536 in real profit. And unlike the other companies, that did not generate real value for Comfort Air, we have gotten 3 HVAC-related service calls for this company, proving that we're able to generate value for these companies.
With the results of our MVP and trust within our ideas and ourselves, we believe that we are ready to launch our business and start acquiring customers and reaching the goals. And the startup cost for our launch would be $4,402. This would be split up into 4 different ways, the first of which is marketing. As a digital marketing company, we of course realize the importance of marketing that plays into the success of a business. And with this $3,575, it will be a multi-platform, multi-pronged digital marketing strategy. The second one is brand registration and development. In order to create a successful brand, you have to have a strong image. And branding will include graphic design and registering our business as an LLC in the state of Illinois. The third price for this is our AI tool. As Devin mentioned earlier, we are working on developing a revolutionary AI system that will help our ads be unlike anything else on the market, and this will cost us $240. And for our last and final cost, it will be web design. We are an online and not local-based company, so the website is the first way customers interact with us. And through this, we need a strong website and a strong landing page, and the cost of that will be on the screen. And to show our dedication and our commitment to our business, we are putting in $1,902 of our own money, which will leave us with an asking cost of $2,500 on a loan of 5% yearly. Grow, expand, and succeed with digital with Mercury Marketing.
Thank you for listening.
All right, board, you have 5 minutes.
Okay, thank you. Great presentation. I'll admit I did not understand all of what you're doing, which just shows how contemporary you guys are and how uncontemporary I am. One thing I just don't understand, you said you're going to charge $1,200 for the ads, $1,000 of profit, so that's $2,200. But I didn't understand how long that lasts. Like, is this charged every month? Once a year? Are you one and done? And is there any type of like recurring revenue that you'll charge Comfort Air?
Yes, so that price is for us to set up and manage their campaign for 1 month.
1 month, okay. And have you been doing it over a month?
Yeah, so with Comfort Air, we are currently 3 weeks into his subscription.
Are they going to renew for another month?
Yes, as of right now, okay. Yes.
And 3 calls, that's 3 phone calls they got, or did they convert into customers?
3 phone calls we got. One thing, we don't try to pester them and be in their face, taking up all their time. So we don't know if he converted off of those 3 calls, but we've generated that for him.
Yeah, so that's where I'm getting at. If those 3 calls turned into customers, what you really should try to understand is what those customers mean to that, to Comfort Air. And that will tell you how valuable your offering is to them. And I think you might be missing something in your math, because if you will get this every single month, one customer will spend $12,000 with you. And if you get 6 customers, that's $70,000. So there might be a little bit of recurring revenue there that would be an amazing business model. So really congratulations, and impressive on how you thought through the efficacy of your business.
On? Okay. Wow, a lot of passion for HVAC. I was curious, I understand the size of the market is why you landed there. Is there a connection?
Yeah, HVAC, if you look at it and you look at the research, they have the highest conversion rate of all, like any industry in the online atmosphere. And so basically what that means is when the customers click on their ads, as you were saying, 3.3% is an incredibly high rate of conversion for those customers. And HVAC stands at the top in terms of conversion rate for Google Ads.
Okay, and so just last question. So that's the bulk of your business and the target that you're going after in year one. As you're projecting really high growth, are you expanding beyond this customer segment?
As of right now, no. Those numbers are just for the HVAC industry. However, many HVAC companies also offer plumbing services, so we could also expand into plumbing.
So for this AI system that you're going to develop, is this something that is solely unique to HVAC companies?
No, the technology could be applied to any industry that uses Google search.
So is this a potential expansion opportunity in the future for you?
Yes.
One last question. Share with us how you're going to manage a non-compete. I understand you're going to concentrate in the HVAC industry, but an HVAC who is operating out of Barrington in the center of the village is probably not going to look too kindly upon you to take on another competitor who's just a mile down the road. So how are you going to handle that?
So from the HVAC CEOs that we talked to, we found that they service generally around a 15 to 20 mile radius. So we will be limiting it to one customer per 20 mile radius.
Couple coaching ideas.
1 minute.
HVAC, it's great. Love the fact that you focus on the conversion rate. It's a really small market compared to where you could be. And to add on to what Michael said, that recurring revenue is how you get 10, 20 times revenue valuations of your company. You guys are onto something. You're going to have to see what that looks like. And you're going to have to more clearly define what you're going to put into for 1,200 and what you're going to get out. If you can start showing return on that investment, if you give me 1,200 bucks, I'll show you three clients that are going to pay you, that are going to pay me $700 a piece. Now I've got real interest because now I've got a 33% pay to go get those clients. You're onto something, I think. But start doing that math that Michael was talking about because that's where your business explodes and stretch way beyond the HVAC world.
Yeah, so the numbers we presented, that was our profit, not our revenue. The revenue for year one was closer to $50,000.
All right, thank you. That was Mercury Marketing. So the first two groups, fantastic work. Like I, you know, in my MBA class, they have to give a presentation and I got to work with some people that are not even close to where these kids are. And it's a big challenge for me to listen to some of it. So it's refreshing to hear stuff like this, even though like Michael, I don't understand half of what we just witnessed, with the AI. All right. So our next group that we have, Pod Protect, mentored by Andrew Bukta, an AirPod case cover with slide lock mechanisms to prevent pods from falling out when they're dropped. Please welcome Yas Asija, Peter Kazaglis, Suhani Modi, and Caroline Turnbull.
Hi, our names are Suhani, Yash, Caroline, and Peter, and we are part of Pod Protect. How many of you own AirPods or know of someone that owns AirPods? As we all know, AirPods can be quite expensive, with them being $250. One of the easiest ways to break or lose your AirPod buds is by dropping the case. All it takes is losing one of your AirPod buds, and then boom, you have to buy a brand new pair. In fact, this is so common that it's even happened to me. I was walking through the busy hallways of Barrington High School, dropped my AirPod case, and the buds flew out, and I lost them. Not only was this very inconvenient for me, but also very costly, and I had to work hard to buy a brand new pair. I then went to my team, and I found out that this was a common problem, even between all of us, which led us to think, why is this still such a painful problem? According to CBS News, over $1 billion is spent on AirPod replacements annually due to this very problem. Such a high quality product being so easy to damage didn't sit right with me and my team, so we created Pod Protect. Pod Protect is a high quality AirPod case cover that features a durable side lock mechanism that prevents your case from opening up when dropped. Pod Protect is durable because it's made from many high quality materials, convenient because of the easy to use slide lock mechanics, and stylish because it will come in a wide array of color choices and patterns.
So you may be wondering, who's gonna buy Pod Protect? Well, allow me to introduce Jane. Jane is a 17-year-old student in an affluent community who frequently spends her time listening to music on platforms such as Apple Music, Spotify, Spotify, and Amazon Music. Due to her being a student, she's often carrying a lot of things, and as a result, she drops her things in the hallway. Jane is then stopped. She's then forced to stop and pick them up. And with Pod Protect, her and the millions of other students like her are able to save themselves the time and embarrassment of having to do so, as well as the hefty price they'd have to pay if they lost them. So with that being said, this brings us to our market size, where we can see that $1.3 billion is spent every year on AirPod accessories, and of that $1.3 billion, $202 million is spent by teenagers and frequent flyers.
So now I'm going to be getting into our MVP testing, which was our in-market experience that we conducted. We wanted to test the viability of our products and how it would perform after launch using quantitative and qualitative data. We set up two experiments, one being sending out advertisements to get people onto our landing page, and the other one being testing our prototype and getting prototype testers. So, our timeline, in month one was getting the testers and getting the advertisements out, and month two was analyzing the data and creating a final product. Here are our metric goals. We wanted to achieve 700 website views, 250 emails collected, and 50 surveys completed. As you can see, we surpassed each and every one of those goals. And a way that we got people to our landing page is 25% through ads, 53% through a booth that we 57% through a booth that we held, and the rest was through flyers and word of mouth. Here's an example of two of the ads that we conducted, one being on Instagram, where we were able to pay for it and we were directly able to contact the people interested in our product. And the other was a TikTok, which was a free source. We were able to use relatable content to draw people in. We garnered 5,000 views on the ad and 5,000 views on TikTok, getting us 60 website viewers. We also held a booth where we talked to students at our school and got them interested in our product. They scanned a QR and saw our website. On our website, you can go and see our product, and if you click to pre-order, you'd see a message saying something like, "Whoops, you caught us before we're ready, but put in your email to get future updates." Here's why we did that. We wanted to see the high versus general interest for our product to confirm that people were interested. So not only were they going on the website, but they were putting in their email to get future updates. So we got our conversion rate of 18.7%, confirming that people were very interested in the product.
So with our prototypes, we wanted to collect qualitative data, and we did this by launching testing periods. So to do this, we had six initial prototypes, which we'd give out to our testing groups for a six-day period. And after that, they'd fill out a brief survey telling us about their experience with our prototype. And then we'd apply their feedback and repeat the process. So this is our first version case. It proved our solution to be very effective, as the AirPods did not fall out. However, the pin on the case broke and the sliding wasn't very smooth, so in the future they'd recommend that we add a stronger pin. With that being said, we wanted to try out a separate type of locking mechanism for our second prototype. So this is a more magnetic slider, and it worked. The testers liked the magnetic feel, however it wasn't very effective, and the AirPods still flew out. So therefore, we combined the feedback from both of those and created our third version, which features two rails and a slider, and this case was also very effective. It's been our most effective yet, and in the future, our customers would like to see more support for that top rail, as it is a bit flimsy right now. However, with that being said, these are all just prototypes, which are merely 3D printed, and it's safe to say that once we get our product professionally made, all of these flaws will be addressed, such as the slider not being very smooth and the pin breaking. However, from our survey, we found out that the testers liked the overall concept of our product, and they'd be willing to put in their own money into our final product. So now, when this brings us to our competitors, where we can see cases from companies such as iCurrer and Voma. This case shown above is a leather pouch-like case, which you have to manually button and unbutton the case. Not only is this time-consuming, but it's also very inefficient. And with Pod Protect, that will not happen. This is our second case, which is more of a mechanical button that we actually bought and tested ourselves. As you can see, going along with their views, it was not very effective, and the button actually ended up breaking.
In order to determine our price, we sent out a survey in which we got 87 responses. We asked them what they thought our product would be worth if someone else was to buy it, and the general consensus was around $15. Now, to make each unit, to make one unit of our product, it's going to cost $2.60. That includes the manufacturing and the shipping of our product. Now, given our product price is $15, That gets us a gross profit margin of 82.6%. In our first year, we estimate we'll make $21,750 by selling 1,500 cases. We're going to be doing this primarily online through our website. Now, in the fifth year, we estimate we'll make $101,000 by selling over 7,000 cases. Now, for this, we'll combine using our online web store and through retail in order to sell our product and reach that goal. We are asking for $12,000 for a 17% stake in our company. This $12,000 will be used for various things. $650 will go into legal fees, such as our LLC filing fee and provisional patent fee. The bulk of our money is going into the injection mold, which is required to make our product. In order to get this number, we asked Accurate Plastics how much we'd have to give them in order for them to make our injection mold, and they told us that we'd have to pay them $8,000. And then the rest of the money is going to initial inventory and marketing, along with a small liquidity cushion for any excess expenses that arise.
So our company's exit strategy consists of a five-year exit plan in which we would sell our company to one of our competitors, such as iCareer or Voma, and our money multiple is 3.3 times, and our internal rate of return is 33.6%. This means that investing in our company has the potential to generate a significant amount of return for our investors, and our exit strategy is designed to maximize profits. With a very dedicated team and a proven track record of interest, we are confident that our company will be able to thrive in the years to come. Thank you for listening, and remember to keep your AirPods set with
PodProtect.
Board, you have 5 minutes.
Great job, PodProtect. Really great. My question is about testing the actual safety to the AirPods. Have you tackled any sort of testing to make sure the case does protect them from breaking when they're dropped? Or how, if you haven't yet, how would you tackle that?
So the case has proven to prevent nicks and scratches along the case from moderate heights that you would drop your AirPods from. So, I mean, unless you're throwing your AirPods in the air, I mean, if they fall out of your pocket, they completely protect any damage.
In the future, though, we will definitely have, like, height tests where we'll test multiple times just to ensure we can, like, promise people our percentage of accuracy and not breaking your AirPods.
Great presentation, guys. I really like the iterative product design that you guys went through with all the options that you looked at. Highly engaging presentation, and really liked the goal orientation that you guys had. Clearly, you like the numbers and achieving the goals. Good job there. The question I have is, did you guys consider 3D printing to come up with the final design that would perhaps be could be done just before you invest in the tooling? Because tooling can be a one-shot deal.
So we looked into 3D printing our final product. However, after interviewing a bunch of high school students and like our target audience, they said that they would not really pay for, like the majority wasn't going to pay for a 3D printed product because okay. They felt like they could like make it themselves or some stuff along that lines, and they didn't think it looked as clean as it's supposed to be. However, if you get it injection molded, it looks a lot better.
Sure.
And it comes as one piece, so we have to do less work, which okay. is a big thing. So it cuts down on labor.
Okay, good. Thank you.
How much research would you do to determine demand before you created the injection mold? And then if you had a high amount of demand, what's your estimate of the timeline to get that mold created and actually product designed or manufactured?
For the amount of interest, we have sent out many surveys, obviously just to mostly people in our high school, and we've seen a high demand for the product. As for the rest of the world, I think we would use more of our advertising effects for that and get people's opinions. For the timeline, I know we spoke to one of the manufacturers, and I'm not sure about the exact timeline of that, but we would definitely look into that.
Great job. Very good presentation. Question with the mold. Is the mold going to be the case and the slide lock together or just the slide lock?
So in order for it to like minimize how much time it takes us, because if we made the lock and then we bought the case separately, we'd be the ones to apply it to the case, which would take time. So what you do is we're gonna order, like the mold comes as one whole piece. So we won't have to like put it together. It'll come put together already.
Great presentation. You're all good presenters. Definitely had that stuff with, you know, in your head and knew what you were talking about. So well done. And also great job in the evolution of the prototypes. It looks like each one got a little bit better. You got real feedback from people and improved it each step of the way. That's real hard to do. And I think the last one, you know, is pretty close. So great acumen there. It looks like it's only for AirPods Pro. And I'm not an Apple expert, but I think it's been a year and a half since Apple's updated the AirPods Pro in the case. And with an $8,000 cost for an injection mold, let's say Apple tweaks the case by 3 millimeters, or you get a huge demand for AirPods 4 or whatever else is coming out. How do you guys plan to scale the business and evolve your product with Apple's products?
We do know, we've spoken to people who own Beats, and we've heard that this is also a problem with them. Additionally, people like the aspect of the case also as almost a fidget mechanism. So I think if that was ever a problem, we could find other aspects to market. But obviously, as well, people do own AirPods for a long amount of time. So we think that we would have at least a 5-year plan of that. But we would definitely have to look into other methods if they did come out with a new case.
Great. Thank you, board. Thank you, Pod Protect. All right, fourth up on the list, we have Digimax, whose mentors are Matt Hauer and Laura Kersinek. They're another social media marketing agency that creates, edits, and manages social media campaigns for medical practices in the Chicagoland area. Please welcome Adam Hyderi, Priyansh Jain, and Matt Lewis.
Tell you a little story. In Fassie, Foot and Ankle Specialists of Illinois, a local medical practice, the clock hits 5 on a Friday afternoon. Judy, an employee at Fassie, groans as she hits the post button at the bottom of the Instagram video she's been carefully piecing together for the past hour, knowing she could have completed her payroll update instead. What's the point of this stupid social media anyway? Judy says in her head, looking at the 5 likes on the last post, and the post before that, and the post before that. It doesn't do anything for the business. See, if Judy stopped posting, Fassie would risk falling in line with nearly 6.5 million other small businesses in the US who don't utilize digital marketing at all. Judy returns home and the entire weekend dreads her return to work on Monday, where she'll be overwhelmed with the tasks that she never had time to finish. With that, let me introduce you to Digimax, the most successful group in the MVP stage of incubator program history. I'm Matt Lewis, and I'm here to tell you just a little bit more about what Digimax can do to solve Judy's all-too-common problem.
I'm Adam Hyderi, and I'll tell you guys about our market and the numbers.
I'm Priyansh Jain, and I'll be convincing you to give us some money.
So Digimax is a social media marketing agency that offers to create, edit, and manage social media campaigns for medical practices with under 20 employees in the Chicagoland area. If you'd like to see some of our work in action, you can scan this QR code right here, and it will take you to one of our actual clients' accounts. As a social media marketing agency, we've chosen to deal almost exclusively with short-form video content, around 5 to 60 seconds, which is easily translatable over our 4 platforms, TikTok, YouTube, Instagram, and Facebook. So what makes us special? While many businesses, especially those out of the incubator program, might be discredited by the fact that they are run by high schoolers, that is not the case with us. We actually use it to our advantage. Because we are high schoolers and part of the social media generation, we leverage our greater knowledge to optimize these accounts for the best chance at success. As well as that, we are individual to our clients. We custom tailor our campaigns based on the client's needs. Whether they want to build a name for their practice or a community around their practice, we tailor our campaign to meet their practice goals. And finally, the most important thing is that we are local to our clients. We break the social media marketing agency norm of templated, pre-made content. We actually go in and film original content with the doctors, which not only allows us to build a greater connection with the doctors, but for the doctors to build a greater connection with their followers.
So our total addressable market is $271 billion, and this encompasses the total digital ad spend in the United States. Inside of this, there's a serviceable addressable market, which we will be targeting, and that's measured at $278 million. In year one, we plan to reach 30 potential clients at a 20% conversion rate for a 0.09% market share. So as you can tell, we're in an absolutely massive market, and with a massive market comes tons of competition. As you can see, our competitors do some things well, but there's one gaping hole in this market that only Digimax can fill, and it's the fact that we're local to our clients and we can build a community around them. So one unit of our service is 1 month of our service, and this is measured at $2,000. In this unit, our clients get a custom-built campaign with 4 to 5 videos posted per week. As well as this, they get community interaction to boost the amount of accounts reached. In year one, we don't plan on doing any outsourcing, and we'll do everything ourselves. So our cost of goods sold is $0, leaving us with an 100% gross profit margin. In year one, we project to reel in $132,000 in revenue, and after salaries and other expenses, $44,500 in net profit. But in order to reach these goals, we need solid marketing strategies. After trying things like a website and email marketing, we narrowed it down to word of mouth, social media, and phone calls. In years 2 through 5, we plan on raising our unit price from $2,000 to $3,000 a month. And in order to do this, we're going to hire a secondary company called Feedbird, which will handle all of the editing duties. So all we have to do is go into the practices and schedule the film days. And the price of Feedbird is $448 per client. As well as this, we need to utilize our year one tactics with the larger client base, as well as add new tactics like getting into medical magazines, as well as medical conventions. Because we interviewed 5 doctors, and they all said they're required to attend some sort of medical convention on the regular. For example, CDS for dentists. Knowing this, we're projected to reel in $1.75 million in revenue in year 5, as well as $705,000 in net profit.
So for the last 3 months, we've been testing our business in the real world and adjusting it accordingly. So at the beginning of this, we had 3 goals. One, we wanted to test our solution, see if our campaigns were actually successful. We were hoping to see increased interactions in around 3 months. Next, we wanted to test our customer relationships. That means measuring demand and getting 10 meetings with potential clients. Lastly, we wanted to test our revenue streams and raise $4,000 in revenue and potentially raise our price to $4,000 a month. Now, using our year one marketing tactics and making over 40 phone calls and going to 5 practices in person, we were able to meet with these 11 potential practices. Out of these practices, these 9 showed interest, and the 2 in green are our current clients. Now, in order to test our solution, we were running full-fledged campaigns for Foot and Ankle Specialist of Illinois, who's on our freemium plan, and ChiroFit, who's paying us $2,000 a month. Along the way, we learned many things, such as the fact that every platform has its own difference, like Instagram and YouTube. Next, we learned that accounts can get shadow banned if they're not used for a couple years. And lastly, we learned that there's a timeline of around 4 to 5 months for all of these campaigns.
Not only have we been learning a lot, but we've been seeing a lot of great results as well. As you can see on top, in the first month of the Foot and Ankle campaign, we reached 16,000% more accounts than they had been doing before. And in the second image, you can see these campaigns accelerating over time. With a 64,000% increase in Instagram reach, it shows that our campaigns are, in fact, accelerating. As well as that, on the bottom, you can see an increase in interactions. With a 2,000% increase, we can prove that not only are people seeing these accounts, but they're interacting and becoming community members.
So here are two testimonials from an end-of-the-year survey we sent to both our clients just 2 weeks ago. On the top, you'll see Dr. Hyderi verifying our year one marketing tactics, mentioning how she'll refer us to another practice. On the bottom, you'll see Dr. Dave verifying our sustainability, mentioning how he will stay with us for the next few months, at least. In addition, we received amazing feedback on the content that we've produced. And of course, our favorite one is, whoever is running this account needs a raise. And frankly, we agree, which is why we tried raising our price to $4,000 a month. However, practices said that they need to see more evidence of a full-fledged campaign before they can pay us this type of money, which is why we're trying to raise our price to $3,000 a month instead. Now, our last goal was to raise $4,000 in revenue. While this is a very ambitious goal, Digimax is not one to stand down from this challenge. And in fact, I'm very proud to announce that we have raised all $4,000 in revenue, the most during the MVP stage in incubator history. So what we are asking for is a $6,000 line of credit at 7.5% interest. This entails $800 in administrative costs for trademark, LLC, and copyright, $200 in marketing for website paid ads, $2,800 in equipment, and a $2,100 liquidity cushion. We want to seem like a professional agency to our client, which is why we plan on upgrading our filming equipment, our lights, our editing software, and our storage for the film. Our exit strategy is to sell at the end of 5 years for $1.48 million to 97 Switch, a local marketing company. Thank you for listening, and remember to maximize your digital potential with Digimax.
All right, board, you got 5 minutes.
Hello, hello. All right, great. Congratulations. That's quite an accomplishment of receiving $4,000 of revenue so far. I thought as you were going to, you know, share more of the economics, I was wondering, why would you even need our money? It seems like you can self-fund a lot of this growth. And so I was really pleasantly surprised to see you were only asking for a line of credit, because you can give it back to us when you don't need it. And not giving up equity in this business, I'm going to be a little like coaching you, because I would want equity in the business, but not getting equity is probably the best way to go. So I applaud you for changing however you're going after your financing around that angle. So I think what is probably most interesting was the line of you saying you're going to make $132,000 in the next 12 months. Forget about the business model just for a minute. You know, $2,000 a month times X number of, the math gets you there. What I'm most interested is how the three of you are going to organize yourselves to execute on that promise of $132,000 of revenue.
Okay, so $132,000 in revenue means 6 clients for every month. So the way we like split it up right now is we have a filmer and then we have an editor. So I go in and film for these practices for film days, and then Matt and Adam edit all the videos, push it on our management software, and then they post it. So this has been working well for now, but we do acknowledge the fact that with 6 clients, it can become a lot, which is why we plan on using Feedbird. Feedbird is $448 a month. What they do, they take care of all the editing, and they post for us, and they interact with the community. So all we're left to do is sign on clients and get film, and then just send it to Feedbird.
In year one specifically, we feel our team's strong enough to manage the client base that we're hoping to reach. With Priyansh dealing with all of the outside happenings with the business, client communication, other stuff like that, as well as being the one that films, Adam and I are left to fully manage the campaigns. So I do
the processing of the film. It all gets delivered to Adam, who edits all of our videos, and then I put it into our management software. So running right now with that, without Feedbird, we feel confident that we can manage the clients in year one on our own.
Thank you.
A quick follow-on question there. How many hours are you guys spending now to support the two clients that you have? How many hours a week?
So we've calculated that it takes around 32 to 40 hours per month per client as of right now. We figure that's going to get faster. Once we get the nicer video equipment, that'll allow us to export the videos faster straight into our editing software and straight into the management software without having to bounce around from platform to platform. So some of the editing time and the posting time will be reduced.
Okay, good. Thank you. Love the confidence and the playfulness. Good job on the presentation, guys.
I'll ditto that. Can you talk about your clients and what do they look for as a return on their investment for $3,000 a month?
Yeah, so we can actually see like the full funnel of when people are scrolling on the Instagram page to when they click onto the page. And from there, we have their website linked in their bio, and we can see how many people actually tap onto the website. For example, in the foot and ankle specialist campaign, we've actually seen a 900% increase in website taps. And from there, it goes on the website. We can't really manage it past that, but we actually have received various DMs on the ChiroFit account about coming in for adjustments and setting up appointments, which proves that our social media videos lead to actual business in the practice.
In addition, so our clients have, as we've seen, want different things. Dr. Hyderi, when we went in, she said she was really concerned with the numbers. That means she wanted views, interactions, stuff like that. However, when we went to Dr. Dave, he said he really wanted to build a community, which means more of the larger and informational type of content. So although that type of content doesn't get as many views or interactions, he was fine with that because that's the type of content he wanted to push out.
All right, great. Thank you, Digimax. We are on to our last and final group, Doteki Brush. We're their mentor, Eric Hochstein. The company Doteki Brush has created a premium, durable grill brush with four interchangeable heads to help grillers get an effective clean on all types of grilling surfaces. Sorry. Please help me welcome team members Nishka Kole, Aiden Marchese, Graham Valskis, and Madeline Yoon.
My name is Madeline Yoon, this is Nishka Kolhe, Graham Valskis, and Aiden Marchese, and we are Doteki Brush. So like the 77.1 million other Americans who own a grill, my family and I love grilling, so much so that each year we host our own grill party. So before the party this past summer, I unveiled the black cover off of my grill and took out our brush to prepare the grates for the countless hours of grilling that were about to occur, only to find it looking a little something like this. Who else here has experienced a grill like this before? As you can see, there was a huge buildup of gunk and debris, and no matter how hard I pressed or scraped, nothing would come off. But why exactly is this a problem? First of all, debris can deposit bacteria onto the grates, posing a huge health risk if ingested. Each, on average, there are about 1.7 million microbes of bacteria per square centimeter on a grill. That's 124% more than a toilet seat. That's disgusting. In addition, a buildup of gunk and debris can be a huge fire hazard. Each year, there are about 10 deaths, 100 injuries, and $37 million in property loss from grill fires. As I continued to scrub the grates, not only did I realize that nothing was coming off, but the bristles on my grill brush were actually falling off onto the grill. I soon found out that this problem is not just exclusive to me and my family. In fact, 2,000 plus hospitalizations occur each year for swallowing grill brush bristles.
Once I got the grill as clean as I possibly could, I went back inside to get all the tools that I needed to start grilling. I ended up needing these many things to grill just one single burger. To alleviate these problems, our company, Dotechi Brush, has created a premium, durable grill brush with interchangeable heads so all grillers can clean all types of the grill easily. We understand that it's hard to clean all types of grills, and we have alleviated this problem through our versatile design. We have currently designed four different interchangeable heads that lock onto the same handle in the same way, allowing the flow from grilling and cleaning and serving to be extremely easy. In addition to the effectiveness our interchangeable heads bring, there's also an environmentally friendly benefit as well. We found out that last year about 10.9 million grill brushes were sold, with meaning that around the same number were also thrown out because grill brushes only last from about 6 months to a year. However, with our interchangeable heads, you do not need to throw out the entire grill brush once one head deteriorates. Instead, you can simply swap out one head for another, thus limiting waste. The versatility of our grill brush also allows it to be extremely effective. Our product works on a wide variety of surfaces, from flat tops to grill grates, giving it that pristine look like when you first bought the grill. We also understand that handles bend and bristles don't last, and we have alleviated this problem through our final unique value proposition, our durability. Our bristles are made out of stainless steel and are coiled in such a way to ensure that the bristles are not going to fall out when cleaning the grill. Additionally, our handle is made out of aluminum, which is a very sturdy and durable material and will not bend when pressing down onto the grill. Additionally, aluminum is 100% recyclable, thus contributing to our environmentally friendly aspect as well. We also plan to implement a silicon grip in the future for maximum comfort.
All right, so through our market research, we were able to determine that our total addressable market for the grill accessories industry is $1.3 billion. Now, taking into account that we are specifically selling as a grill brush, hence our name, that gives us a serviceable addressable market of $280 million. Now, we are targeting adult grillers ages 35 to 55, making over $100,000, as this is a premium product, which gives us a share of market of $197,000. So here we have three main competitors, as you can see, Weber being the biggest name up there. However, they each lack in four distinct areas, whether being cost-effective, effective for use, good quality, as well as having variety, which, as Madeline mentions, Dotechi Brush covers it all. So for our actual marketing, we decided to market on three different platforms. We went with Facebook, Instagram, and Google Ads to see which is most effective in reaching these grillers. And so here are four of the ads that we put out, the two on the left being our unique value propositions, as Madeline had mentioned earlier, as well as the two on the right focusing on our pricing. So we decided to do some A-B testing with our pricing, one starting at $29.99 and the other starting at $39.99 to see what our customers are really willing and able to pay. However, we saw a very minor difference between these, so that way we were able to determine that our customers are willing and able to pay that higher price. And so based off of our analytics from this, in terms of conversions through emails, as well as the amount of website clicks, the amount that we are spending on each ad, as well as the amount of people reached, we are going to be prioritizing our advertising through Google Ads in the future.
In our first year, we will be selling exclusively on our website. And in years 2 through 5, we will be selling on our website, as well as in stores like Ace Hardware, Williams-Sonoma, and Home Depot. Currently, we have 5 individual units. In the white, we have our cost of goods sold. And in the orange, we have our estimated selling price, which ranges from $20 to $40 a unit. We also have gross margins ranging from 40% to 60%. In year one, we are estimating to sell 6,400 units, 2,400 of which are handles. We project just under $200,000 in revenue with $25,000 net profit. In year 5, we estimate to sell 69,000 units, 22,500 of which are handles. We project $2.1 million in revenue with $273,000 net profit.
After the implementation of our MVP, the landing page, we had over 2,000 website visits where users had an average of 30 seconds of engagement on our website. We also had 31 emails sent to us from prospective buyers, and had 8 people put items in their cart and go through the entire checkout process of our product. We met with Jumpfly, a digital advertising agency, to learn how we can optimize both our ads and website, two very important aspects because we are only selling on our website in year 1 and still mainly selling on our websites in years 2 through 5. The two main points of feedback that they gave us was that we should put a video of our product in the background of our website to really get the users excited and willing to buy our product. We also plan to change our current call to action color from pink to a more masculine color to attract our customer segment. We interviewed 21 people in person with our brush. All of them said that the dent pin was annoying. 9 of them said that the brush was too heavy. 4 judges at a CHSI pitch suggested that we raise the price because grillers already willing to pay a relatively high price for a premium product will be willing to pay a little bit more. 4 people also wanted color customization. We are changing from a $3 dent pin to a 73-cent lock metal spring clip. This not only will make our product significantly easier to use, it will also reduce the cost of goods for each unit of the handle that we produce. We still need to conduct further interviews to determine if the weight of our product is truly an issue, as we did have a relatively even split between those that disliked the weight of our product and those that liked the weight of our product because it made it feel premium and durable. We are requesting for $20,000 for a 15% stake in our company, the majority of which will go to startup inventory, and the rest will go to administrative, developmental, marketing costs, and a small liquidity cushion. We are also putting $1,000 of our own money into this company to start up the business. We plan to sell to Weber in year 5 for $550,000. We found that Weber was a viable company to sell to because they've bought out other companies of similar size in the past. Your $20,000 initial investment will yield a $175,000 return in year 5 after selling to Weber. You will also get a 68% internal rate of return and an 8.6 times money multiplier.
So I'm sure many of you are wondering now at this point, what exactly does Doteki Brush mean? Doteki means dynamic in Japanese, and we hope to embrace this definition into our product with our versatility and our interchangeable heads in order to create a better brush for a better grill. Thank you.
Board, you have 5 minutes.
Oh my gosh. It got even better than we saw you a week ago. Crazy. Remind everybody, you guys are high school, right? You're not adults. So where do you get this made? Is this made in America? Is it made overseas? How quick can you get this kind of inventory in?
The prototype itself was made in China, and we are going to use a different manufacturer, also in China though, for the mass-made product. We're using the company Xometry to produce them, and they can produce however many units that we want. We could go up to 10,000 or even more, but we do need a like specialized quote then. But they're a huge company, so they can produce as many or as little as we need.
Great job.
I second that on the presentation. Very impressive. You're juniors in high school, so congratulations. Can you walk me through your plans, if you have a plan, on packaging the heads with the wand?
Yeah, so we have a, we already kind of anticipated this question, and Aiden had 3D modeled what one package may look like if we included everything into this package. And you know, we talked about last time selling in stores like Williams-Sonoma and the higher end stores because our product is a premium product. And hopefully, you know, we can go from like the starter package for grillers to like the ultimate package for grill masters. But as of now, we are just selling like individually, but in the future, we definitely hope to include packages into our units.
I just wanted to ask if the judges would get a discount, like some kind of discount code or something like that. Because sign me up. This is fantastic. I wish it was available for Father's Day this year. I guess we'll have to wait till next, but maybe Christmas, you think? Yeah. Excellent. I would just I would really feature on your website, like, go with the package, right? And then, you know, this is the package, you know, if you bought them separately, it's $120, but for you, it's $99.99, right? Or something like that. Excellent, very polished, and you guys are ready for Shark Tank. That's great.
One quick question here. Have you done any research on the popularity of each of the 4 designs? You know, just anecdotally for myself, I use the spatula 100% of the time. I use the brush 100% of the time, and the other two I probably wouldn't use. And given that your inventory ask is 15,000, does it make sense to focus on making sure you develop, you know, two popular heads versus all four popular heads if there's not a lot of demand for one of those four heads?
So we met with Barbecue Guys. They're a large company that sets up a lot of outdoor spaces, and they said that flat top grills are really a new thing that's getting popular because you don't need the propane to power it, so it's more environmentally friendly. And that's why we have the pumice stone head. So currently we're producing more of those than the other heads themselves, along with the standard cleaning head.
Fantastic quality of the product. But honestly, most impressive to me is that you're already doing things like A/B testing and web analytics at this stage. Wow. You talked a lot about stats on germs and grill fires and safety from the bristles falling off and all that. Does the Dotechi brush do does it mitigate those things any better than other brushes, or were you just calling alert to the need to use brushes and tools in general?
Yeah, so this kind of ties into our heads, specifically like the grill grate head, the standard brush head. And so our bristles are coiled really tightly so that even if you're really going at your grill, it's not going to fall off. And this is a technique used by other competitors, not all of them, but some of them. And so there hasn't been a problem with the technique that they've used, and we're kind of, mimicking their manner into our product. Additionally, our bristles are made out of stainless steel, which is considerably more effective than any other material regarding grill brushes.
The amount of inventory that you're funding, there's $15,000 of the $20,000 that you're asking for. As we think about funding you, what's the minimum amount of inventory you would need in order to, sell the product and then recycle whatever profit you make to buy more inventory? Have you done that math? And is 15,000 the number?
That's very close to the point where the gross margins are almost zero. Once you start getting into the 10 to 12,000, that's when you start getting negative returns.
Oh, okay, so there's a volume discount. The more you buy from the supplier in China, the lower the cost.
Correct, yes, it's significant. And once, currently we're around 220 units of the handle, and then 110, give or few, depending on the demand for the products themselves for the heads. And once you get up to 500, the cost of goods goes down for about $4 for each product.
Okay, so the gross profit at the $15,000 minimum order, what type of gross profit will you yield if you sell all of those?
That's the, it's about $12 per unit. So selling all of those, I'm not sure on the
exact math. It gets you $12 per unit.
Yeah.
And how many units are you buying?
220 handles, and then an average of 110 of each of the heads.
Okay. Okay, thank you.
All right, thank you, Dotechi Brush. All right, as you can see now, the board is taking some time to go back and deliberate. I want to apologize to my students this year. I mentioned earlier that I'm getting an MBA, and part of the reason for that is once I get my MBA, the program becomes a dual credit class. So kids will be able to get college credit for taking my class. After what I've seen up here, they should be getting MBA credit for how they're presenting. So I want to apologize that I didn't do it sooner for all of you. Now, as the Bard goes backstage, take some time to deliberate on what was presented to them this evening. We always have some time to showcase some of the talent that has come out of the program in the past. So we have two girls here today I'm about to introduce. They're founders of a company called Sitter Hub, which is still active in my accelerator program. Some of you might have used their services in the past Some of you might not. Maybe you will after tonight. So please help me welcome, Please help me welcome Olivia Lagerschild and Emma Juffrenbrook.
All right, thank you, Hogs, for the warm welcome, and hello, everyone. Welcome to Pitch Night. Thank you for being here. We first just wanted to give a huge congratulations to all of the teams who presented tonight. You all really did an amazing job. And it's really, yeah. It's crazy to think about the fact that Emma and I were up here 4 years ago pitching our business. It was probably one of the most memorable and rewarding experiences of our lives, but also one of the most nerve-wracking moments of our lives as well. But before we go any further, we just want to introduce ourselves. So, hi, I'm Olivia Lagerschult, and I am a rising senior at the University of Illinois, where I'm studying accounting and pursuing minors in Spanish and the HEF Technology and Management program, and I graduated from Barrington in 2020.
And hi, I'm Emma, likewise to Olivia. I graduated from Barrington in 2020. I also attend the University of Illinois, and I'm studying bioengineering.
So through the incubator program, Emma and I created SitterHub in 2018, which is a hyperlocal babysitting platform that connects high school babysitters with parents in the area who are in need of a babysitter. And so currently we are hiring our fourth set of employees, and we're planning to expand to the Lake Zurich community later this fall. And so if any of you in the audience are interested in our business or are in need of a babysitter, feel free to find Emma and I later tonight. We'd love to chat with you, or you can visit our website at sitter-hub.com. But believe it or not, we actually aren't here today just to promote our business and tell you everything about our business. We're also here today to tell you about some of the key takeaways and lessons that we have from the incubator program that have translated into our college years.
Thanks, Olivia, for sharing that little background and introduction to our business. So we'll be talking about kind of three main takeaways and lessons that we learned through our incubator experience and kind of where we've seen them post graduating from high school. So the first lesson that I want to talk about is very cliche, but it's how to view challenges and failures as learning opportunities. But we truly feel that this defined our incubator experience and helped us as building blocks for the future. So starting a business in high school isn't super easy. Again, congratulations to everyone that made it here and everyone that's been through the program. As you know, there's a lot of unexpected roadblocks that you'll have to run into. But the lesson here is, how do you adapt to those challenges and failures and pivot to success? So when Olivia and I first started this business, we first had it as last minute sitting. However, after interviewing parents and kind of building our initial business model, we realized this wasn't really the problem that we wanted to solve or the problem that was apparent between parents and Barrington. We had to go back to square one and iterate again and face the challenge of going back to the drawing board on how do we address the real problem. That's when we kind of realized we needed to find reliable and trustworthy sitters. We used the information that we had found through these interviews and primary research to efficiently solve our problem, which was how do we best meet the needs of our customers. It's a little lesson in itself that you always want to find the root cause of the problem before jumping into the expected solution. Therefore, we didn't try to mold our business to this expected solution, but we identified the real problem and constructed our business around that. We always face challenges, whether that was getting new customers, how do we create the best marketing strategies, and COVID was a huge roadblock for us. But we were able to work through these challenges and failures and learn a lot from them, and also have a lot of growth and perseverance through that that we've taken on into college. We always try to break down a problem into manageable, actionable steps, and that's how you'll be able to be successful. So therefore, what I'll say is, try to embrace the challenge, use this as the frustration as fuel for success, and learn from your failures as a growth opportunity.
So the second lesson that we really took away from the incubator program that we want to mention tonight is the importance of being a team player. So for those of you who don't know how the class is structured, HOGS randomly assigns teams at the beginning of the year, and this is your group for the remainder of the year. So when CitterHub was placed into a group, we all barely even knew each other. And we were all really confused how we were going to be able to create a business together without even knowing anything about each other. But this is really what makes the class so valuable, because we were able to come together and learn so much about how to communicate within a team, how to respect each other's opinions and ideas, how to effectively solve problems in groups, and how to hold each other accountable. So if one person wasn't holding up their end of the stick, it didn't just come at the cost of the grade of the class, but also at the cost of the business itself and the integrity of the business. And we gained exposure to this we had exposure to group projects in other high school classes, but none of them really required this type of team interaction and collaboration that, as many of you know, is really vital and crucial in the real world and any professional experience, and in college. Specifically for me in college, every single involvement, organization, and class that I've taken has involved some sort of group project or team setting. So I give full credit to the incubator program for exposing me to the necessary skills to be a valuable part of a team, and also just teaching me a lot about the importance of being a team player.
And then the final part that we wanted to touch on is instilling self-confidence. So as you saw all those amazing presentations, everyone that went up here had tons of confidence. So this is something that we've definitely learned through our experience. And we're both very thankful that we had this experience in order to kind of help us reveal our confidence. So I'm sure as maybe some of you, I don't know, when I went into incubator, I was pretty shy. I didn't like talking to crowds. I still don't love it, like standing
up
here. It's a little scary, but I think we've definitely improved since then. As you know, we give biweekly presentations, run through different exercises on selling yourself, but also selling your business. And on top of that, through our business, we had to interview potential customers, talk to businesses, and really just promote the business and sell the brand. So little by little, our confidence sort of increased and our communication skills as well. By the time pitch night came, I was scared to death presenting. And as Olivia had said, 4 years ago, we were on the same stage. And I'm still very scared now, but I think it's a little better. I will say, I feel like everyone gets stage fright, except for Hoggs, probably. He's confident, as you guys know. But by the time senior year came around and Accelerator was here, the presentations that we were giving were very routine, and I could talk to nearly anyone because of this confidence that I had built. I think the great thing about Incubator is you're exposed to so many different opportunities where you're really pushed out of your comfort zone and put in these uncomfortable situations to test your confidence and to really grow. Now we've kind of tried to continue this confidence within college. And I never really considered myself a confident person, and that's for two reasons. I always thought a confident person had to be the loudest in the room and someone with the biggest personality. And secondly, I never gave myself enough credit to be proud and confident of my accomplishments. But I will say, I do believe that confidence is more quiet than loud, and always remember to be proud of your accomplishments. Within my first year of college, I didn't really feel that my major aligned well with kind of what I wanted to do full time, and didn't really align with my passions, my personality, or my values. It was much the safe option to continue on my engineering trajectory and just become a biomedical engineer at Abbott, because that's kind of what everyone told me to do and that's what I thought I should do. But I had the curiosity and the confidence to investigate into the business world, fueled by my incubator background in high school, and now I plan to pursue a career in consulting. But as I said, I wouldn't have been able to step outside my comfort zone without the confidence that had been instilled in me because of this experience. So now we both know how to ask for help, network with professionals, and get the opportunities that we want because of this confidence. So all you have to do is walk into the room, raise your hand, and ask the question, because you have nothing to lose.
So now, before leaving, we just wanted to offer two pieces of advice that we wish that we knew when we were starting our business. The first piece of advice is to get comfortable getting out of your comfort zone and taking risks and just trying new things. So at the end of the day, just take the risk. Whether the outcome is a success or a failure, you're going to learn something from it and you're going to be better. The second piece of advice is to take advantage of the connectedness of the Barrington community. This is something that has allowed our business to really grow and become more well-known within the Barrington community and within the high school. And it's something that we've learned to appreciate over time and appreciate how valuable the community really is for our business. And then now lastly, we just wanted to say thank you to Hogs for everything, for being a mentor, for pushing us to be the best that we can be, and for really truly caring about us inside and outside of the classroom. I think one of the most memorable experiences that we have with Hogs is when he had to push us to get out of our extreme senioritis that we had. So thank you for that and for telling us to keep going. But also we wanted to say happy 10th anniversary to the incubator program. We're really grateful that we got to be a part of it. And once again, thank you all for being here and congratulations to all the groups. You did great. And we wish you the best of luck with everything.
Thank you.
Well, like I was saying earlier, these are some of the reasons why we love the profession. You know, just to go off a little bit of what Emma and Olivia were talking about, the accelerator group, I took them on a field trip in, I can't remember if it was January or February or something, and we went down to a place called 1871 in the city where there was a pitch competition. And I had put in one of my accelerator groups, so the second year kids, and everyone else that was competing from other schools were incubator students, so first year. So after the first four groups went, you know, I'm just looking at my students and they're shaking their heads in I don't know what they were thinking, but they weren't happy with what they were seeing in terms of the delivery. And then my group went up there and just and nailed it. And after the event, we went to lunch. And all they could talk about was how the other groups didn't do this and they didn't do that and something was wrong here and they didn't do it. And I stopped them. I said, do you understand why you can do that? Because we've been practicing. We do over 20 presentations a year. And it's not just out of mid-air that these things happen. So it's through a lot of practice and hard work. And before the board talks, I just want one more thing, because Emma brought up loud and quiet. Obviously, I'm the loud kind. But earlier today, the yearbooks were passed out yesterday or today, and kids were coming to the classroom and asking for you to sign the yearbook. And I had a student from last year that came up and asked if I would sign her yearbook. And we talked for a few minutes. That is the most she said in that 2 minutes than the entire last year in the classroom. You know, you barely knew she existed. She was that quiet. In the corner, quiet, didn't say much. When she had to present, she presented. And then I asked her, so what are you doing? She goes, well, I'm going to Loyola. What are you majoring in? Entrepreneurship. And I realized that there's a lot of kids that just sit there and they absorb everything. And they take everything in. And they're the quiet type. But once it's all said and done, at some point they're going to crack the egg. And they're going to come out and they're going to fly high. So that was an important time for me, and I'm glad Emma mentioned it and Olivia. So now, the time that we've all been waiting for, the board is back. I'm going to introduce Michael Miles to come up and say a few words and to introduce the results of the board's decisions. Thank you, everybody.
Amy?
Live,
there you go.
Live here.
Okay, whoa, now we're live. First of all, students, teams, those were really, really incredible presentations. I think over the 10 years that we've been doing this, that crop of presentations, Hogs, was like the best. And so congratulations to you as well. One thing that we haven't mentioned, I don't think, is we do this on a national basis, and we have a national pitch, and teams from around the country submit videos, and we fly them in, and you know, there's a big presentation in June of every year downtown in the city. And I really truly believe all five of these teams have the skill set and the background to be on the stage at that national presentation. And that's saying a lot, because there's some really, really amazing teams that we see throughout the years. So here's how this works. We basically represent a venture capital fund or a private equity fund. We have a limited amount of money that the job of the board to deploy that capital to teams that we believe in and that we think will succeed. And in the world of private equity and venture capital, people that we think are going to succeed and pay us back and make money. So that's what our job is about. And it's hard to fund every team that you see. In fact, you can't. You just you see so many presentations, you would never be able to deploy enough. You know, you just can't fund every team. So if you're not funded today, you know, don't take it, take that energy and channel it to go out to other sources of funding. There are plenty of other ways to raise money. You all have businesses that are worthy of funding, and keep pitching. And you can pitch at our national pitch, you can get an application, you can go to other pitch competitions, you can raise money through friends and family. Some of your businesses, actually, you can self-fund and just go out and bootstrap them and get, you know, more revenue and sell one product and go buy two products. And you know, some of the marketing businesses where you're doing most of the work yourselves. So there's also options of just bootstrapping your businesses as well. So we, again, have a limited amount of funding. And by the way, I should probably talk about where the funding has come from. So you all the taxpayers in the room here, don't think that your taxpayer money is being used to fund student business ventures. The funding came about 10 years ago, and there were 10 really generous initial donors that all funded. I think we raised in collection at the very beginning something like $800,000, and $200,000 or $300,000 went into the classroom. And this pot of money that we've had, we've invested it in the stock market, and every year we deploy about 5% of it. So we have enough funding in the bank that every year, if we fund out about $25,000, we're able to, the program will stay around for the forever, hopefully, if we're good custodians of the money. So it's a big thanks for the folks that made those contributions 10 years ago, and to allow a really authentic education program like this to continue. So taxpayers, don't worry. But it's really unique. It's a really unique opportunity for the Barrington, you know, community to have this type of program. The other cool aspect, and students, am I getting you a little bit waiting for your, you know, but that's fine, because I, you know, we're going to go with this a little bit. There's one other really nifty aspect of this program. Carl mentioned that we're in five or six different countries, and we have 120,000 students taking this program. Every other school that uses the program pays Uncharted Learning to use our curriculum and use our program. And what we structured 10 years ago was to
because we're a non-for-profit, we created a royalty program that goes back to the Barrington Education Foundation. So this whole idea of community collaborating with the schools has enabled Uncharted Learning to become a profitable nonprofit. I mean, we're not wildly profitable, but we're enough to be able to fund a royalty back to Barrington High School. So I believe, every year the funding on this for the last 7 years has been around $100,000 a year, and it will continue, for many more years. So if you're involved in this program as a mentor, as a coach, as a board member, and just know that the good work that you're doing, and particularly the Uncharted Learning team of expanding the program nationally, is coming back to help Barrington become even a stronger school district through a lot of donations coming back. Okay, so enough about that. Let's get on to the teams. First of all, Carl mentioned this earlier. When we started the program, it was over this economic development opportunity that Carl was involved with. And I think this first team that we're funding, I couldn't help but think about, wow, that came true. We have these businesses in the Barrington area that are doing good and doing okay, but could they do even better with infusing student talent into their business model? And this particular team that we're funding, I'm like, wow, what if you took a group of students that took over the digital marketing for, in this case, doctors, and made them better? How cool is that? So we have the Digimax team. Come on up here. We'd love to fund you. Congratulations. Yeah, I mean, think about it. As this team goes out and helps doctors in Barrington become more profitable, how good is that for our community? And getting more and more customers in their business. And guys, your presentation was amazing. And your talent is real. And we're super excited to give you a line of credit for $6,000.
Yeah, stay up.
Okay. Again, we can only do a couple teams here. So the final team that we have funded tonight. We don't often, I don't think we do products very often, because products are hard. Like, and particularly when you're in high school and you have to, develop a product and you have 1 year to do it, and then you basically become seniors and you have 1 year to sell the product. And, it takes a lot to do some manufacturing and all that. But if you all had the benefit of holding the Doki brush up here, you would say this is a legitimate product that is already done. And congratulations. Wonderful. Wonderful. Yeah, guys, amazing how you developed that product, amazing how you demoed it, amazing your presentation skills, the A-B testing, everything that you guys did at the was super impressive. We're excited to be a partner of yours. We're excited to fund you at the full $20,000. We would even go further to say, as your growth goes crazy, you're going to need to have more and more inventory. If that's the case, don't forget about us. There's more where that came from if you have a ton of success. All right?
All right, everybody. Thank you so much. Thank you for all the teams for competing. Thank you to the board, everybody in the district, and thank you all to the parents and the students for coming out this evening. Have a great rest of the night and a great rest of your school year.